morning. You're listening to 9:10 a.m. Superstation. My name is Robert Ficano. We have the usual panel with us, which Scotty Boman, Police Commissioner Willie Burton, and Tom Choske. I want to welcome everybody aboard. We've got some people who are going to be joining us later on. We have Virginia Burton Harris, who is going to talk to us about Wayne County and some of the policies, and she's an attorney, and I think she's throwing her hat in the ring for a prosecutor. Also, we have Bernie Porn, who just released a poll, which I guess is not surprising to many people, the way it's been going, is that Biden is, Vice President Biden, building like a 12-point lead over President Trump here in the state of Michigan, and Michigan was considered one of the battleground states at this point. So, first of all, I want to welcome everybody aboard. I know that it's been a busy week for a lot of people, including things just even breaking last night, not necessarily in Detroit, but in Atlanta, where the police chief has vacated her position. I understand she's still going to be with the department. The mayor has asked and has fired a police officer that has shot an African-American in the back. Apparently, there was some kind of altercation at a Wendy's and involving a stun gun, and then he started to run away, and then apparently he was shot in the back and killed. So it seems like the lesson keeps repeating itself, and it would seem in a time like this that any officer drawing their gun would make sure that it's going to be for the proper use at this point and not let their emotions ride away from it. So I know the officer is going to be afforded due process, like everybody is, who's accused of a crime, but at the same time, with the video and everything else, it just doesn't look, like he's been paying attention at all, especially the past 2 weeks as to what's going on and what he ended up doing in this case. So I know, Willie, you saw some of that, probably in the news, and Tom and Scotty, if you have any input on any of that or any words of wisdom for us here.
Yes, Bob. You know, right now, you know, this is another sad moment, you know, with the law enforcement, more so pertaining to citizens, you know. We gotta push for more oversight. We gotta push for more training when it comes to officers in uniforms. I know Detroit officers got tasers approved back in 2016, and they didn't get deployed until 2017. But you know, this is another incident, and you know, it's really sad because it just shows that you know, officers need more training across the board.
You know, and just to go off of what Commissioner Burton is talking about, that this is a tragedy. I always want to like bring it back to Detroit here, and I think that you know, looking at the tragedy and the problems that they're going through in Atlanta, and comparing them to where we are here, there's one difference that we have with Atlanta and Detroit, and that is we have a strong board of police commissioners. Now, I mean, some of our commissioners on that board aren't very good. But, you know, like with Commissioner Burton, he demands transparency into the police force so that when it comes to use of force, when it comes to holding officers accountable, you know, we got the community out here, Scotty, that's fighting a long time to make sure that abusive officers are taken care of. We already have a culture and are building a culture in Detroit that, Bob, like you said, holds officers accountable and makes sure that they only draw their weapons when it's absolutely necessary to do so. That's something that we've been leading in Detroit in, and we need to even go further. You know, I just want to commend Commissioner Burton, and I'd love to hear him talk a little bit about the work that he's trying to do on the police commission to really take our leading system in Detroit and make it even better.
Well, one of the things I've been pushing for and advocating here in Detroit is more police community relations, community policing. And that would be, you know, I think that other departments, you know, focus more and invest more in community relations policing, community policing, I think we wouldn't have as many of these casualties that we have or as tragedies. It's always sad when we lose a brother or sister in our community. We gotta give officers more training across the board. I just think that the training that officers have is a step. We need to take it a step further when we have more evaluation of training, yearly training, year-round training. But right now, the world is pushing for more training, more oversight, more transparency. But we also pushing for community policing. We need our officers to be police, to be peace officers.
Yeah, at one time they were all described as peace officers. I mean, the nomenclature, the language has shifted now where they call it policing versus even public safety. I mean, it's interesting the way some of the dynamics have changed of what we call our police now. At one time they were considered peace officers and, you know, it was supposed to be for public safety. If you look at what they're sworn in to do is to, you know, is to protect. And some of that now has seemed to be turned on its head in the way some of it's been looked at. Now, Commissioner Burton, I know that there were several motions that you made at the Police Commission, and some of these issues are going to come to the light pretty quickly here in Detroit. If I can, first, though, you can join us at 313-778-7600. That's 313-778-7600. But there were several motions, and including, now, I understand that the facial recognition issue contract, really, is up in front of the City Council this Tuesday, which I believe has been moved up a month now, which, for whatever reason, they've done that. And ironically, Detroit's voting whether they should continue the facial recognition contract with the contractor. And at the same time, you see some major corporations such as IBM, Amazon, saying that they're not going to continue on with the facial recognition. They said to Congress, come up with some rules if you're going to have us do this. And they pulled back and they stopped supplying some law enforcement communities and things like that. So, but I've seen a little bit about it coming up in front of the City Council on Tuesday. I know you made a motion to at least suspend it for a year until if there are going to be any more rules written or just get rid of it completely. But it seems like it's on this path that they're going to continue on. And it's not a cheap contract from what I understand.
Exactly. Right now, the City of Detroit is in a contract with DataWorks Plus is the vendor for facial recognition. We saw Amazon, we saw IBM, we saw Microsoft scale back and say, hey, we put a pause on police officers using facial recognition. You know, here in the City of Detroit, America's black and poor city should be the last city that we bring in its racial technology, which is facial recognition. I put a motion out there to my colleagues, and I urge my colleagues to do the right thing. So my motion was clear. Let's ban Detroit Police Department from using facial recognition for 1 year, a one-year moratorium. And my colleagues would not support the motion. I did get a support on the motion from Commissioner Bill Davis out of District 7, and also support from Commissioner Darrell Brown out of District 1. But to the rest of our colleagues on the Detroit Board of Police Commissioners, you have the right to, you have the time, this is the right time right now to be on the right side of history. I urge you to shut it down. Shut down this facial recognition. Shut down this this over-surveillance right here in the City of Detroit. The citizens of Detroit spoke loudly during the commissioners meeting. We had over 100 people timed into the commissioners' Zoom meeting. And during public comment, 22 people stepped up to the mic and say, hey, we don't want it. Shut it down.
Yeah, I understand. It was
trying to shut down the public comments a lot, too.
Why don't you explain that, Scotty? What do you mean?
Well, I know a number of people have been getting letters saying that from Jermaine Weirich speaking on behalf of the Board of Police Commissioners. Apparently, he's been sending out letters without asking the Board of Police Commissioners if they agree with him. I found that out, too. And I got one of those letters. I'm barred until further investigation from participating in citizen comments. A couple other activists have also contacted me and said that they were threatened with not being able to speak if they continued to make political comments, whatever that means.
Political comments to a political board? Okay, or elected board, anyway.
How do you not make political comments talking about anything relevant at a Board of Police Commissioners meeting?
That's interesting. So they said that you're actually going to be banned from participating. Well, they're doing it by Zoom now, right now, anyway. That you're banned from...
Well, this is news to my ears. You know, I remember not long ago, a little while ago, where I was actually assaulted at a police board of commissioners meeting. I mean, it was Mother Bernice Swanga came and striking the commissioner's table, almost hitting me and Commissioner Darrell Brown, and Deputy Chief Patterson was sitting there as well, and he almost got hit with that cane. There was no arrest. There was no talk to Mother Bernice, and she wasn't banned from the meeting. So, you know, this is news to my ears. I mean, you can have someone come to a police commissioner meeting, swing a cane, and almost hate the commissioner while he's in session and doesn't get banned. You know, but here it is, you ban in free speech for those that speak during public comments. I mean,
I do not like the actions
or the directions of this board.
It doesn't ring that you can actually do that. Generally, Scotty, if you're doing it during general comments or, you know, they got public comment portion, whenever that is during the meeting, in theory, you can talk about anything you want. I mean, I don't know, but they can't restrict the topic you're going to talk about. You know, if somebody wanted to say that they thought that the National Guard should come in or something like that, which has become very political as well, would that be banned? You know, what you want to say? I'm just saying, you know, there's always extremes that are going to be talked about during public comment, and I'd be really surprised how any public body can ban the public comment. They can limit the time period that you can speak, but they can't really tell you what you got to talk about. That really encroaches into censorship.
Obviously. Oh, and Ashley Smith, we didn't get a letter. She's a sister of Shelby Smith, who is unbeaten. But she was skipped over again, like multiple times they've skipped her over. They occasionally let her out, but they actually said her name and then didn't let her speak to the mic. And, of course, we know about, I guess most of us would, about Commissioner Burton over a week ago, where he actually held up a note to the video saying, I'm trying to make a point, let me talk. And they kept it muted. And you could see the little mute icon right on the video.
It sounds like it's very heavy-handed the way that they're treating it. Have you picked up anything about what's going to happen with the facial recognition contract in front of the city council? Are the votes there? Does anybody have any pulse on this?
I don't have any votes now.
I'm not sure how it's going to go this week on city council. You know, I can say that Detroit City Council did approve the $1 million grant that they received a few years back. How, you know, are they listening to voters, listening to their constituents now? As far as said now, they share a condition. To the city this week.
I think the difficulty, even what's counterintuitive about it, is that even if you're a person that supported the facial recognition, everybody's now being told to wear a mask. So I'm sure, the tool couldn't even work, even if you said that it, you know,
that it had a purpose. And, you know, that's why people were out paying for masks and stuff so they can't be distinguished as to what's happening. And now you got, you know, advising all the citizens to wear masks. And so how's that going to, you know, become consistent with what the facial recognition is supposed to do? I mean, we know racially it's been not able to make a lot of distinction, you know, if you're an African American. And now with the mask, it seems like it's going to make this tool pretty useless at this point in trying to function at all in the way it's supposed to happen. So with IBM, with Amazon, and others that are banning it, going to law enforcement, it just seems like the natural thing to do, if nothing else, is at least suspend it for a year at this point. And then you could reappropriate some of that money. They're talking about shifting where you put some of the money that you're trying to find for the community and things like that. Well, there's one spot that you probably could find at least for a year that would be put in place of that.
With being Amazon, but you have to rely on Amazon and Microsoft to do something to actually protect our community from racism, that the Board of Police Commissioners is just refusing to do anything to protect our own community. And right now, they're shutting down their own members. They're shutting down democracy, and they're just going to sit by as this technology is continually used to criminalize our community. There was a famous incident that just happened within the last week where this system was used on people at a gas station. So it's in use, and it's in use today. And we need to ban it, and we need the commission to finally listen to the people, listen to Commissioner Burton, and ban it once and for all. Not just rely on Microsoft, not just rely on Congress. We got to do it for ourselves here in Detroit.
So what was the incident? You said there was an incident at a gas station?
Yeah, there was an incident where there was a shooting at a gas station. I believe it was on the west side there. Don't quote me. I can't remember the location of the gas station. And the police are running around touting how they used this facial recognition technology to catch the perpetrator. However, they never said how they did it. And exactly to your point, this person was clearly not wearing a mask. What if this person was wearing a mask? We don't know if they not only caught this person, we don't know if it was the right person. We don't know if charges have been filed. We don't know anything about it. We know that this technology is used, and the department was quick to say this is part of our investigation, but we don't know if it was effective. We don't know if this is technology that was used to help arrest the right person and get a dangerous person off the street, or if this was just one more incident where this technology misidentified someone of color and caused another negative interaction with police that could have resulted in more death.
So did they arrest the wrong person? I guess I'm trying to understand it. But we don't know.
No. We don't know these things. We hear about the department's initial arrest, but we don't know if it was the right person. I know that there was also an incident, I know Commissioner Burton and I were talking about this not too long ago, of someone who was arrested by DPD. They were just doing their job. This was a while ago, this was a couple of years back. They were just doing their job, arrested by DPD, held for over 15 hours, and they weren't the right person. Complete misidentification. So we know DPE does that. However, they don't report on their mistake.
Hmm. Okay, well, we have a number of callers here. Also, eventually I'd like to touch on if we can.
The thing about it is, the Detroit Police Department secure funded, implemented their program, used it for 2 years, and no one knew about it. Once again, this is a lack of transparency.
Okay. Well, we're going to break. We have a number of calls. We're going to get to them. And then we also have Victoria Burton. Harris is going to be joining us as well. So you listen to 910 AM Superstation. We're going to be right back.
Yes. Let me talk to you. See, when it feels like the sun ain't shining bright enough, it's like the devil's finding work to give an idol up. And though I'm blessed, I still gotta handle the things I go through. It's good to have a friend.
Central Park Deli on Losser between 8 and 9 Mile Road is serving everything fresh and delicious. Open Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 9 p.m. and Saturdays from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. Central Park Deli will deliver to businesses from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. daily. At Central Park Deli, you will enjoy our hefty sandwiches, our delicious soups made fresh daily, our fresh made-to-order stir-fried dinners, and the best roll-up sandwiches in town, and a variety of meats such as club, buffalo chicken, Italian, Greek, hot corned beef, veggie roll-ups, and more. Central Park Deli offers a great dining experience, fast and efficient carryout, and fantastic tray catering for special events. Central Park Deli makes ordering your food in advance fast and easy with our new online platform and mobile app. Central Park Deli on Losser between 8 and 9 Mile Road is serving everything fresh and delicious.
Are you drowning in debt? Struggling just to make minimum payments? It's not your fault. Serious debt can happen to anyone, but there is hope. Our debt-free program has helped thousands of good people, just like you, eliminate their credit card debt. Call us today, and we will dramatically reduce your credit card debt down to just a fraction of what you owe. The call is free. The consultation is free. Take control of your credit debt. Take control of your life again. Call now to see how our debt-free program can work for you.
Call 800-872-5230.
If you or a loved one underwent hernia surgery between 2010 and 2016 and then suffered serious complications, call right now. You may be entitled to financial compensation. Complications associated with PhysoMesh include chronic pain, infection, adhesions, mesh migration, reopening of the hernia, and other serious injuries. Call right now.
Call 1-800-799-2091. Again, that's 1-800-799-2091.
Attention! In July 2018, Bayer announced that it will be halting its sales of Assure. The Assure birth control may break or migrate after insertion, puncturing the fallopian tube, resulting in corrective surgery to remove the device. Thousands of women have reported debilitating health problems to the FDA. In April 2018, the FDA restricted sales of Assure to protect women and require that patients receive risk information.
Please call 800-425-9539.
Good morning. You're listening to 910 AM, the Superstation. My name is Robert Ficano. We have with us Police Commissioner Willie Burton, Tom Choske, and Scotty Boman. We have a number of callers, and we will eventually going to be joined here by Victoria Burton-Harris, an attorney, civil rights attorney, and also a candidate, I understand, for Wayne County Prosecutor. I want to say, Mr. Positive, you said you wanted to join us here this morning. What's on your mind?
Good morning, everybody. Mr. Positive is in the house. Hey, there's so many things to discuss. Number one, FART, facial recognition technology. It's a tool. Okay, number one, you use it as a tool. You don't get rid of it because here's the problem. People don't like to snitch. You ask around, what did you see? What did you hear? This is an aspect of trying to get the criminal off the street. Number two, you guys, this is going to be a problem. I don't know in Atlanta what you guys saw, but I saw tussling the gentleman at Wendy's, tussling with the two police officers. What's going to happen is you're going to want no one to get to be a police officer. You're going to be afraid. In that moment of life decision, you've got to think about, oh, geez, do I shoot? Am I going to lose my job? Am I going to get sued?
But the officers weren't facing immediate harm, immediate threat. I mean, he had a taser. Now, we've been told that tasers are not fatal.
Why didn't he give up? Was he? Did they say? Was he drunk or did he pass out?
Yeah, he was drunk. They said he was drunk.
He was drunk? Okay. Funny that, you know, he's resting in a drive-thru, and I'm thinking, okay, well, he could just pull to the side, but that's another story. Number four, the media has to be involved. They said it on national radio last night that you get Fox, CNN, and MSNBC. everyone takes a side. The police are right, the police are wrong, and there's a middle ground. And that's being perpetuated on TV. And last but not least, the family unit, the structure, whether you're black or white, crimes, abortion, fatherless people in the household, black-on-black crime, white-on-white crime. I'm always going to be controversial because we've got to face the facts. Once we understand the facts, we can draw conclusions, we can draw solace, we can get to the root of the problem, and that's what it's all about. We have to find out why, you know, it's like you said, Bobby, it's been around for 3 weeks, this violence. Why aren't police officers going, wow, we got to go into this with a lot of trepidation. We got to do everything by the book, and we got to start going forward by the book. But here's the problem.
Well, Mr. Positive.
Mr. Positive, police officer. Does Scotty want to be a police officer? Okay. Okay, what's you asking, Bobby, or Mr. Chomsky? Or Mr. Willie Burton?
Well,
ask me anything?
A couple of us have been involved in law enforcement for a really long time. So, but there is no doubt. Reality, what perception becomes reality. And right now, there is a perception that if you're African American, there is a lot of trepidation if a police officer is going to pull you over. Whether it is or isn't, the reality is, you know, the perception now has become the reality. And they have some of the facts to back it up. I mean, it's like, that's a dissect because we don't know all the facts in Atlanta and what happened. But he was not a threat to anybody running away.
That is the problem. You're right. He wasn't a threat. They could have pulled him over, got EMT. Yes, I totally agree that it escalated. But when you see the video, I mean, he's wrestling. He's throwing these guys around. They're throwing each other around. And I'm thinking, why
was
the alcohol there?
Wait, Mr. Positive, there's a video where someone's being thrown around. Which one are we referring to here?
Atlanta.
The one at the Wendy's. They're showing him, and you got the police officer trying to restrain his arm on the ground, sitting there, and he's like fighting. And I'm thinking, why did it escalate to this? Why is he fighting? Why? You know, when you're drunk, you're not thinking clearly. If he was drunk, we don't know. They're going to have to do a thing. But
they said he was passed out in the drive-through lane. Somebody's passed out in the drive-through lane. Eventually, he was. He wasn't in the drive-through lane when the police got there.
Okay, now could you say this real quick? Could you say this because the African-American community is being, spotlighted on this? Wouldn't the African-American community, in a sense, because it's going on until we start resolving this, really just follow procedure? Don't fight as much as you can? Even though, let's say you're pulled over. Okay. You know deep down inside that I'm probably being arrested because I'm African-American. Okay, I know that. So let's not flip off. Let's not say anything. Then let's go after this because they have to be aware also, the African-American community has to be aware that the police are gunning for them. Sorry about the choice of words, but going after them. So the African-American community should just go, okay, this police officer probably has racial intent in his heart, so I'm going to do everything that I can. You know, hopefully the body cam is on. And I'm just going to follow procedure. And then after that, then you go to the courts. Then you just don't say anything. You just don't. No matter how much you want to say it, you just go, okay, officer. Okay, I will listen. Please. I'm having my hands on the wheel. I'm not moving. I'm looking up. I'm offering you respect, officer, sir. And just let it go from there. Because everyone knows that everyone's on high alert.
People want to be respected, whether you're African American or whether you're a police officer as well. The problem is, it seems like it escalates so quickly into a fatal force, into a fatal, a situation, and, it's just disproportionately happened. That's it. I'll tell you what, we got a guest on. Thanks, Mr. Farrah. We appreciate calling
you guys. Rock on.
Thank you. Oh, wow.
Yes. I think part of the distinction that needs to be made is a lot of people think that because people are upset about police brutality that they're against police, and the idea that somehow police would not want to join the police department or that it would prevent them from doing their job, I think is wrong. It's people being upset about them doing their job incorrectly. And yeah. I think an officer that is afraid of being, or a person who's afraid of becoming a police officer because they won't be able to do chokeholds, maybe they should not do that.
Well, Bob, I look at it like this.
Chokeholds and stuff. Go ahead.
You know, I look at it like this. You know, this is as a black man here in America, I'm outraged. As a commissioner of the city of Detroit, District 5, you know, is just looking at all of these different incidents across the country. I'm looking at Minnesota. I'm looking at now Atlanta. Officers are not following a training. We got to put teeth in policy. We gotta have a strong discipline when officer doesn't follow their training. I think from an oversight standpoint, we gotta be able to hold officers accountable. This brother right here was 27 years old in Atlanta. He was a father. He was shot, killed. He was fleeing. The officer's life wasn't in danger. You know, and so we're talking about a 27-year-old.
Got away from him. Than anything else. Who knows what the shock process he was going through. All right, we have with us Victoria Burton-Harris, who is an active attorney. Victoria, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Sure. I know you've been active in the community. There's certain reforms in Wayne County you'd like to see. I know you've thrown your hat in the ring as running for prosecutor, which is going to be probably a tall order, but you're bound and determined to get through it. Why don't you tell us some of the reforms you'd like to see in Wayne County that you think there's some abuses? Obviously, the whole police situation right now has just exploded on the scene, but there may be other issues as well that you think the criminal justice system isn't responding to.
Sure. One, let me let you know that I can barely hear you. Your volume is good, but you sound muffled on my end. So I'm going to repeat the question to make sure that I understood you. You would like to know what reforms I want to see in Wayne County, specifically in response to this national uprising against police brutality and misconduct?
Yes. Go ahead.
Awesome.
Yes.
So you know that the prosecutor is the gatekeeper to the criminal justice system, and people typically make the connection. And, they realize that the prosecutor is responsible for keeping us safe and prosecuting people, but they rarely make that connection between law enforcement officers and them being held accountable. And so, we have a prosecutor who made her name 30 years ago on the prosecution of the murders of Malice Green. When she was a line prosecutor. But we have to remember that that was kind of a decision that she had a hand in. She was a line prosecutor. She took the case she was given. And when you look now, 30 years later, you have to ask yourself, has our current prosecutor done all that she can to address police misconduct? And that requires you to look beneath the surface, not just the 50 cases in the last 16 years that have been high profile, that she has, charged police officers, not secured convictions, but just charged them. You need to look beneath the surface and ask yourself, these police officers that engage in this misconduct that makes the news, is that the first time they've engaged in it? Or have they possibly engaged in this conduct where their police reports are chock full of lies, where their police reports don't match their body-worn cameras? Are they even wearing their body-worn cameras? Are they activated according to DPD policy when they, you know, have contact with civilians or anticipate contact with civilians? I'm a criminal defense attorney, and I see that every single day. I see police officers say one thing in their report, and when I review the footage and I look all the way to the end, that's where the gold nuggets are. You will see that what they said happened is not at all what happened. And in fact, if you listen to the end of the body cam footage of the film, you'll hear officers question the arresting officers. Hey, man, why'd you arrest them? Oh, you pissed me off. Oh, you wouldn't listen. So that has to change. We are authorizing in our prosecutor's office criminal warrants and charges for crimes that we don't have any evidence to support. And so the onus then becomes on the innocent person and their defense attorney to prove that they're innocent. The prosecutor's job is to prove that a person is guilty. It is not on an innocent person to prove they're innocent, but that's what our criminal justice system has turned into. So one reform I'd like to bring to Wayne County is that my office would not sign criminal warrants authorizing charges based solely on a police report. You need to bring me body cam footage. My line prosecutors in the warrant division will not be allowed to sign those warrants until they review police body cam footage. That is the only way that we start to curb some of this behavior. You also have to hold those bad apples accountable. When you see that a case has come before you as a prosecutor and those body worn cameras have not been activated or turned on, you need to take action. Work with the police chief in these cities and say, hey, you know, this is not acceptable, and you need to do something, because this is the kind of bad apple that turns a whole bunch rotten, because that's where the misconduct starts. So in addition to that reform, I'd also like to bring in restorative justice practices to Wayne County. I'd like to end our cash bail system. I'd like to end the school-to-prison pipeline by not criminalizing our children. I'm going to bring all of our juvenile lifers home. You know, Wayne County is in desperate need of reform. We cannot look at the things that we've done well to make excuses for the reasons why we have not done all that we can and why we are still locking up innocent people. Let me tell you, Commissioner Burton, and you probably know this, but I'm going to remind you. If you look at the National Registry of Exonerees, Wayne County has locked up more innocent people than all other counties combined. And the answer or the response that you will get from your current prosecutor is, initially it was, that's not true. And then we're starting to see her walk it back when she does her own research. And we now are getting the explanation. Well, of course we have, you know, the most wrongfully convicted people because we have the most felonies in the state. Well, the question then becomes, Commissioner Burton, who's bringing the felony charges? You! Why are you bringing people into a criminal justice system and saying, look, well, you're innocent, but, you know, I had to do it because we have more people in our county? That's morally reprehensible. And when did that stop?
What study is this that says there's, what, more charges or convictions of people illegally being held? Are they being, do we have more people being charged or convicted?
No. Oh, there are the date of the conviction is listed on the registry, and the date of their release is listed on the registry. But I got to tell you, Commissioner Burton, even if you just look at those people who are wrongfully prosecuted and charged, that is unacceptable. Why are we charging people, innocent people, and we don't have the evidence to prove it? That's wasting taxpayer dollars. And then we waste taxpayer dollars a second time when we send them through the appellate process and the court process, your elected prosecutor's office fights the release of the person all the way through the appellate court. And then taxpayers spend money a third time trying to get them exonerated or released.
So this is a national register. I'm sorry, I'm just trying to understand. National Registry, where is this located?
If you Google the National Registry, I think it's the National Exoneration Registry, you will see that information. You can search by state, by county, the years will pop up. It is there in black and white.
Okay.
As a trial attorney, yeah, and people don't know that because no one questions what they're being told. they have leaders that tell them something and they say, oh, okay, that must be true because you said it. No, it's quite the opposite. Do your own research. Make your own informed decision, because I promise you, once you look at the research, your eyes will be open and you will never be able to go back.
I had a question.
Go ahead. Go ahead, Scotty.
Okay, I don't know what you're saying either. The question was, because you're ranked for prosecutor, I'm liking what I'm hearing, personal point of view here. But I'm wondering, and I don't know if you can comment, maybe you can't comment on specific cases, but maybe you can say how you handle cases like this. We have a case where an officer was being originally charged with assault and misdemeanor assault and felony misconduct as a police officer, and it's the case of Dwayne Jones. And Cynthia Miller dismissed the felony misconduct charges, but she did it without prejudice. So in cases like that, would you be for going back and bringing in charges that were still applicable if there was sufficient evidence of guilt? You know, where they previously had been
dismissed? Are sufficient evidence. Yes. Yes, the keywords are sufficient evidence. But you as a prosecutor, the onus is on you to go and find that evidence. You know, we like to allow our leaders to back out and throw their hands up when they say, oh, there's not sufficient evidence. Well, ask, have you looked? Have you done all that you can to investigate, to find if there is sufficient evidence? Because oftentimes the answer is no.
Yeah.
Oftentimes the answer is no. You know, as a prosecutor, you should know where evidence is at all times. It doesn't matter if evidence is found on your watch that you didn't know about. The question needs to become, why didn't you know about it? Why doesn't the elected prosecutor know where evidence is in her county? And why is it that for years you can say you were ignorant of this evidence and where it was? I mean, like, we need to ask those questions.
Yeah.
These are our leaders that represent us. Why do we just accept what they say and expect them to tell us when they mess up?
Ms. Harris, a couple things. Number one, I understand there's like 54 police officers, according to Chief Craig, that can't testify in court because of the veracity issues that they've had in the past. Also, though, I think you keep referring to Police Commissioner Burton, that he's bringing the charges. He isn't. The Detroit PD may be bringing the charges. The police commission doesn't bring the charges at this point. I think there might have been some confusion about that. The 54 people that can't testify seems to be a glaring error that's coming out of the police department at this point. And what's interesting is, what do you do with those officers? Because if they make an arrest, what they're basically saying is they can't testify to it in court.
So isn't that a waste of our money to have these officers on the street making arrests that won't go anywhere? Isn't that also dangerous to the citizens?
Yeah, I'm not
100% sure. Many of them have been taken off the street. So many more have not been. And the reason why is because they're not being held accountable anywhere else. So I'm a defense attorney again. We have asked, we have demanded, we have been told by our prosecutor that you as a defense attorney will be furnished with a list of those untruthful officers. Do you think we have that list? Absolutely not. That was one of the very first things that one of the progressive prosecutors in Philadelphia did when he took office. Larry Krasner, a former defense attorney and public defender, as soon as he went into office, he realized this is something that is very simple to do. I can do this in a day. Here you go. Why is it taking so long for us to get that list as defense attorneys in Wayne County? Are we ever going to get it? Probably not from the current prosecutor.
We have some callers, if you don't mind taking them. Fidel, you're on with Ms. Harris.
Hey, good morning. What is the young lady's name?
Victoria Burton-Harris.
Victoria Burton-Harris. Oh, wow. Yes, I like what she's saying. I am a victim of Kim Word. I was charged with a felony firearm, and she threw on two more felonies just to say, well, take the plea to the felony firearm, and we'll throw away the other two felonies. And guess what, y'all? There was never a gun, ever, not from the beginning of the case, not to the end of the case. And while I was in courtroom, there were five more cases that went up like this. Them guys went to prison. Never was a gun on the table. So I agree with you cold-heartedly. I will be looking you up, and I will be voting for you. You're going to get my – that's the only vote that you that they're going to get out of this election out of me. Second of all, Mr. Protest said that people out here don't snitch. That's a lie. That's a lie. You got plenty of guys that's on the stand that just committed a crime with a group of other guys, and they took that cop out and snitched him. He don't know what he's talking about. He put the concerns on the African American. Why don't they quit fight? The blame is on the white officers. Like, do he realize today, just by us getting off the phone, going on with our general life, there could be a potential of another black person unarmed getting shot? A lot of these instances now where a black person have a gun and pointed black at the officer, they got their hands up. They in the car with their wives and their babies on a simple traffic stop, and he telling your listening audience that the black people need to comply. This is the thinking of a lot of Americans, and that's got to stop. Last but not least, y'all, what do y'all mean they need, these officers need more training? If I go to my job three times late, I'm going to get warned after warned, and I'm fired. How do you train somebody who's already been trained to kill you? How do our black officers work with these guys and don't even stick up for their own black community like the protesters are marching on their behalf? They kids, they fathers, they husbands. They could potentially get shot down as well. Why, if this is the playing field, and I'm an officer, and I'm a black officer, I'm going to say, okay, why don't we start shooting white unarmed people, and let's make this fair. They won't even do that. So, again, when y'all say training, what do you mean training? They've been trained to do this. Prosecute them and send their butt to jail, then they'll stop this mess. Thank y'all.
Okay, thank you for that.
And I will be voting for this young lady in the next election.
One of the issues that comes up is that we're using police in so many situations that in the past, you know, have drawn police officers into areas that they probably are not trained in. One of the issues I think that is interesting is a police officer, I think it's still the law, if a police officer actually goes to, if a police officer actually goes to a domestic disturbance, I think they have to end up arresting somebody. And so you're setting a police officer into a volatile situation, and now there's a lot of people saying, well, maybe you should send some social workers or some other type of, you know, support service that's going to help the officer instead of just making it a plain police decision as to what's going to happen.
You know, I got to tell you, I have spent a lot of time prior to us being shut in for COVID, going around Wayne County, speaking to law enforcement officers, both in Detroit and outside of Detroit, like Western Wayne County and downriver areas. And by and large, what I hear is that police officers are terrified because they're spending their day going into these situations and they don't want to. And they admit that they do act out of fear. They act hastily when the more appropriate response, like you just suggested, would be to send trained social workers and folks who are trained in de-escalation tactics, not those who are quick to draw weapons because they don't know what else to do. So why are we not exploring that option? You know, we need to get away from this idea of policing and get more into the conversation of public safety because they are not one and the same.
We have a number of callers. We can get to them here before the end of the hour. John, you're on?
John, hung up. Next caller.
Okay. Al in Detroit, are you with us?
Yes, sir. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yep. Okay, first I want to say, I just found out about Miss Victoria maybe 3 days ago. I just heard her name. So I went and researched her, and I've been reposting and advocating for you ever since. We are proud of you. We need you. We thank you. The second thing I want to address is, I heard the comedian say, you can't reform a cop. And I agree with that. I think we do need to defund and dismantle and replace our police system like they did in New Jersey. Because our system is eroded. We have a long history of data here. We don't have to keep asking ourselves, you know, let's be fair to the police. They've had their chance at showing us something. You know, you get the respect you earn. They have no respect because their system has not earned any respect. It is it's brutal, it's mean, it's corrupt, it's racist. It's all these different things. Just reforming will not help. We need to replace that mindset that is corroded our policing system. That way of policing is done. Younger people reject it wholeheartedly. The only people still embracing that old system are mostly the baby boomer generation and older people. But younger people want no part of it. And I, for
you
one...
But you have to have an alternative... If you do have violence in the neighborhood, who do you call then at that point? How do you respond to violence in the neighborhood?
Yeah, we have violence in the neighborhood because the police have arrested all our parents. The police have arrested all the nonviolent fathers with their racist war on drug policy that they even knew were wrong, but they continue to arrest. So now we have no fathers, we have no coaches, we have no developers, and you say our children are violent. Well, yeah. They're violent because you took all the parents out the home. Before the war on drugs started in 1973, we led this country for 200 straight years in marriage in two-parent homes. That number only started to decline after the war on drugs. So, yeah, these policies create war zone environments and poverty-stricken environments that dysfunctional children grow up in and be developed in. And it's because our leaders have failed us. And they are, and I'm not going to make a case that there is no greater criminal in our community than this policing system that we're dealing with every day. There is no greater criminal. There is nobody I want you to arrest more than I want you to save me from the police because I'm terrified just to ride a 8 mile every day. Terrified.
Al, we appreciate it. We have a number of calls. We appreciate it. Thank you.
I really like this caller. I was just going to say I concur, and I'm glad to hear another voice calling and condemning the war on drugs because it's really a war on people.
Yeah, we have a balance. Yes, I think if we go down that slippery slope of starting to defund police departments, I think we're overreacting to that too. If you completely eliminate the police department, I mean, it just doesn't balance what you need to do.
In my fear,
can I just jump in and say that this caller is spot on? The war on drugs has decimated black families, and it's taken black men away from women, black fathers away from children, black sons away from moms. And that is something that we have failed to acknowledge in this country. When the question is asked, what fuels mass incarceration, the immediate answer should be the failed war on drugs, the war on black people. And the next question that should be asked is, how do you redress those wrongs? You do that by agreeing and advocating for automatic marijuana expungement, right? That's like a basic first step. I've done the research. I've made the connections. There's a company called Code for America. They've done this in California. They've done it in other areas. For a mere $15,000, our county could do automatic expungements of all marijuana convictions. And do you know what that will do for a community to have their record automatically wiped clean using a cell phone and a voter record? Do you know what that means for in terms of opportunities for families?
All right. Well, we still have several callers. We've got a few more minutes here. Pam, you're on.
Hello.
Pam?
Hello.
Hi, Pam.
Hi, how are you?
Good. You're on.
You know, I think the problem, and we're hearing this every day on the news, the problem is police culture versus people culture. What do I mean by that? The residents don't feel that they can trust the police because of the way they police in their community. In turn, the bad cops, and not all of them are bad, or the domestic terrorists, will say, we can't trust the people in the community. If you look at the line in between, the baseline between the police culture and the people culture, it does come out to training. Respect is the first thing. A lot of police officers don't respect the people in the community because they think they're beneath them. You have to respect the people that you police. Second of all, police officers need to be trained in implicit bias. And that's very important. Diversity is good, but you've got to put the word culture before diversity. Now, why am I saying that? If a police officer pulls over a black guy and he says, give me your license, right away that's disrespect. Because you don't say it in that tone of voice and in that manner, give me your license. Because that's what we're accustomed to, being disrespected verbally by some of those rogue cops. When the black guy responds, he says, yo, dog, what you pulling me over? He's not calling you a dog. That's the manner in which he speaks. That's culture. There needs to be a better understanding. Police officers need situational training. What would you do in this situation? It's different than the book. They need to be trained longer before they're put out on the road to deal with people. And I know every area is stressed for cops right now. I want to ask this young lady, it sounds like you're a candidate for prosecutor, what would you do to change the policing culture if you're elected?
Okay.
How could you work with the police?
This is the last call we can take, so go ahead and answer it, and then we appreciate you taking the time this morning. Go ahead, Victoria.
Real quick, I can advocate alongside police chiefs to have longer trainings, to have different folks come in on those trainings, like criminal defense attorneys, to tell them, hey, you know that that's illegal what you do, right? But most importantly, as a prosecutor, what I would have the power to do is to refuse to authorize criminal charges when they bring me warrant requests. So eventually, it will become known you're wasting your time as a police officer going after folks that the prosecutor is not going to prosecute. And so then it becomes a choice. Are you going to continue to go after folks that I won't do anything about, or will you start to change? The message comes from the top down.
Okay. Victoria Burton-Harris, I want to thank you for joining us here today. We appreciate it. And we have a number of callers. We're going to continue on with some of the callers, but also we're going to have another guest on at 9 o'clock. Brittany Porn from Epic MRA did a survey here about the state of Michigan with Biden versus Trump at this point. So with that, if you're listening to 910 AM, the Superstation, my name is Robert Ficano, and we're going to be right back.
Wow, how you been, baby? But I'm saying, even though we probably linked...
This is Reverend Sharpton, and on the last Keeping It Real with Reverend Al Sharpton...
Oh, I just don't count the votes. They're not there with a vote. They just get...
Answered you before, sir, that I know thousands of people that are in the rooms when the votes come in. Every candidate has people in the room. When I've run, I have people in the room. Everybody running is going to have people in the room when the count comes in. The question is making sure we get the right count. The count does not come from them counting ballots. The count comes through technology. This is not 1890. We're not having people at the courthouse standing in line or the schoolhouse and you see the ballot. The question is making sure you have the right voting companies, that they're not hacked or not in any way eliminated. You could have everybody in the world in the room. They will be in the room getting the wrong numbers.
So keep it real daily with me, Al Sharpton.
We all love fried food, but the problem is all that excess oil and fat can cause you to become overweight. Well, now there's the Cook Light Aero Fryer, an amazing kitchen miracle that uses air to fry instead of oil, so you can have the same delicious flavor and crispiness of deep frying using little or no oil. Get that deep fried taste and crispiness with up to 70% fewer calories. Enjoy crispy, delicious fries with little or no oil, guilt-free onion rings, cheesy and delicious mozzarella sticks. Call now and bring the Cook Light Aero Fryer into your home, including including the Cooklight Aero Fryer Recipe Book, the unique patented dual tray, air frying mesh basket and tongs, and stainless steel extender ring. You'll get it all for five easy payments of $29.95. Be one of the first 500 callers and get this 13-piece knife set, a $175 value, yours free. Try Cooklight Aero Fryer for 30 days. If you don't love it, send it back, but keep the 13-piece knife set as our gift to you. Order in the next 10 minutes and we'll include free shipping. Call now or go online to air2fry.com. That's air2fry.com.
I knew I could get myself out of this. I just needed some hope and some help.
I took the first step to recovery when I made the call.
Since 2014, Addiction Hope and Helpline has answered calls for recovery and treatment 24/7, 365 days a year. If you're depressed, drinking, using drugs, or taking pills, call now and talk to someone who cares.
I had problems just getting to sleep, drinking and using pills every night.
I feel like I'm losing control. I'm afraid I'll lose my job or even my family.
Most insurance covers substance abuse. You can get back on track. Call now for hope and help with proven gentle recovery programs.
I never thought that I could be somebody who didn't drink and use drugs.
I have something to hold on to for strength. I'm in recovery, getting the help I need.
Call 800-379-4799, 800-379-4799.
WFDF Farmington Hills, Detroit, 910 AM Superstation, a division of Adele Media.
Good morning. You're listening to 910 AM, the Superstation. My name is Robert Ficano. We have with us Police Commissioner Willie Burton and Scotty Boman and Tom Choske. We're joined right now with a special guest, Mr. Bernie Forn from FFMRA, who just did a survey regarding other things besides, I believe, the presidential race. But that was the top headline about it seems like it's starting to build through 10 to 12 point lead for Joe Biden, former vice president, over a current president, Mr. Trump. And it seems like 5 months after 2016, we really don't want to predict anything, but it seems that at least in Michigan, Mr. Trump's going to have a real hard time catching the former vice president. So, Bernie, I want to welcome you onto the show.
Glad to be back with you.
Thank you. Well, you just had a pretty big statewide poll, and if I remember right, it says 10 to 12 points that the vice president's ahead of the current president, and there doesn't seem to be a lot of path for the president to catch him at this point. So what's some of your observations from your own polling?
Well, he is Biden is leading Trump by 12 points, with Biden actually getting 53 to 41, and Biden is at 50% directly voting with another 3% to lean toward him. And Trump is at 41 with no one leaning toward him. And a lot of this is because of his drop in favorability and his drop in job rating, and the direction of the country is changed significantly. So there's a whole collection of things that are going on. And for the first time, when we ask the question if people will vote to reelect Trump or consider someone else or vote to replace him, 51% said that they will definitely vote to replace Trump. 38% said they would vote to reelect him, and 8% said they'd consider some voting for someone else. And while this is happening in terms of his job rating eroding, and he went from 55%, not much of a change, to 56% negative, but more importantly, on his handling of the coronavirus, 58% give him a negative job rating. And at the same time, you have Gretchen Whitmer getting a 60% positive job rating, and her overall job rating went from 50 to 43% negative in January to now a 55 to 43% positive. And that makes you wonder, why on earth is President Trump attacking Governor Whitmer with her numbers on not only the coronavirus but her overall job rating? And at the same time, it should be noted that the direction of the state is headed in the right direction, narrowly by 47% to 45%, which is in stark contrast to the direction of the country.
Do you anticipate that? Is there a path? If you're sitting at the White House right now and you're looking at least at Michigan, is there a path for him to try to recover any of this lost territory, or is he just give up on Michigan? And it looks like he's playing defense in some of this, where he's looking to go for his rallies, and it looks like they have problems in Arizona, things that normally, even Texas, where normally it would be pretty rock-bed Republican, and it looks like that he's having difficulties even over there. It looks like it could be like he's going to get washed out come this November. But like I said, I've always held back now predicting anything after 2016.
Well, the average of all polls show that among the battleground states, Biden has the strongest lead in Michigan. And there has been a lot of discussion about whether or not Trump may pull out of Michigan, but my guess is he's still going to stay in and do advertising, and I'm assuming he will have the money to do so. And it'll probably be his call, and I doubt if he would give up on Michigan, given that he was successful the last time, and he may well assume that he has the potential of doing the same thing that happened with Clinton. However, Clinton never had even 50%. She was at the highest 47%. And although she had an 11-point lead after the WikiLeaks, that dropped down to 7. And then after the Comey letter, that dropped down to 4-point lead with just a week to go. And at that point, given the trend line and the speed with which it was dropping against Clinton, we said at the time that it was going to be a very close election. And after that, Trump had more visits to Michigan, and Clinton as well brought in people to try and turn out the black vote, which I think came up at least 10,000 votes short.
You know, what's interesting and with the vice president is I know that he authored some of the bills that right now you see some of the social unrest that we see in the country with the type of sentences for drugs and things like that, that a lot of people said have filled up and have been unjustly aimed at African Americans and have filled up some of the presence and things like that. Is that upset people or Democrats, or Trump is just so bad that no matter who's running against him, they're just not going to support Trump, period?
It is a referendum on President Trump, and when you look at the support that Biden has gotten from African Americans, and certainly Clyburn helped a lot, but then it was a steady path after that. And Biden, by the way, in his favorability, went from 44 to 41 to 50 to 46 in terms of his personal favorability. And most of it is negative on Trump, and it will be a referendum on Donald Trump and his actions. And the coronavirus and his reaction to the protesters just to get a photo op, I think that went over very negatively and has had an impact not only in Michigan, but in national polling and in polling in other states. But Michigan is clearly the strongest battleground state for Biden, and that's why I think a lot of people are questioning whether or not it will stay on the radar for the Trump campaign. I don't know whether or not he's going to do a McCain and pull out of Michigan. I kind of doubt it.
I was wondering. Okay, but
go ahead.
I was wondering what proportion, and that brings up because like my old classmate Mike Murphy from Republican Voters Against Trump, who's a strategic advisor to them, has been, you know, one of the people working with reviving the Never Trump movement in the Republican Party. And what I'm wondering is, in your polling, have you identified what percentage of the people not voting for Trump are Republicans, or would otherwise be voting Republican, most likely?
Well, among Republicans, he is getting 94% of the vote, while Biden is getting 97%. And in this poll, the difference is among independents, 63% are voting for Biden. Now, a lot of, Republicans have shifted from identifying themselves as Republicans. However, in this survey, 43% identify as Democrats, 38% as Republicans, and that is right at what the vote to reelect is for Trump. And so he has solidified his vote among Republicans, and they're not so far abandoning him, but I've seen those ads, and I think at some point it's going to have an impact, and it's not just Mike Murphy, but a number of other folks, including the husband of one of President Trump's closest advisors, which they must have very interesting conversations at home, I guess.
He's trying to make his wife unemployed, I guess.
Yeah,
he's been going after him, but I don't think they're going to be earning some money anyway by the time this is all done. Do people feel that it was mostly his reaction to the pandemic, or what's interesting to me also is that he seems to have tried to play off as like Nixon did on, the protesters and silent majority and that type of thing. And I think America's at a different spot right now than when Nixon was trying to play that card. And he doesn't seem to be getting any leverage on, he's pushing law and order and that kind of thing, but he doesn't seem to get the same benefit to it that Nixon did back when he was running for president.
Well, one question that we asked for media, which is the Michigan Information and Transportation Authority, was what's the biggest issue? And the top issue was 36% reopening the state's economy, restoring jobs lost because of the coronavirus. But number two was infrastructure. And just to give you an idea, the law and order president and the law and order candidate, the people that say that controlling crime and drugs among the issues, 2% said that was a top issue, and so he's not really connecting with a top concern. Now, in terms of his dealing with protesters, I think, was certainly very observant in the 60s as a young person, and I remember the impact of the visual news coverage of police dogs, Bull Connor, and hoses, and it caused a lot of people, white folks, to think that this just is not right. However, in the protest back in the 60s, you had maybe 10% to 15% at most who were white people, with mostly African Americans. Now you look at the protest, and I think there's a dramatic difference because in some of those protests you have a majority who are white. Young voters who are very upset, and I think that's going to motivate young voters to participate in the election. I can't imagine that 5 months from now they're just going to not be as engaged as they are now, especially when they look at the potential of getting rid of Trump.
We have some callers, if you don't mind, Bernie. John,
no.
John was a Bernie Point. Go ahead. John, did you call back?
No, he's got to call back again.
Okay. We have Brother Ray. Ray?
No, I guess everybody's taking a break to sit back and listen.
Okay.
Well, that was easy.
Yeah, I know. That one was easy for you. What do you anticipate is going to be any type of reaction by the president? Health has not raised itself as an issue. But I think yesterday, for the first time, we're starting to see some
issues that might be related to his health. Number one, he doesn't release anything, but he hasn't released really his medical records. I was going to say he's in great shape for his age. And yesterday they said for the first time when he addressed the cadets that they saw that he had had a very difficult time lifting the glass to drink. He had his right hand, and he needed his left hand or vice versa to push the glass up to his lips so he could actually take a drink. And they said that he awkwardly tried to get down from the stage and was had a very difficult time trying to negotiate getting off the stage and people had to help him. But I don't know. Health might be one of the things that, again, is another situation. I haven't seen it in much polling or anything like that. You got, you know, two people in their 70s that are running. But if this is true, it probably might be another thing for people to just say, you know what, I'm not going to go with him. I don't think that he's that stable health-wise at this point.
Well, that reminds me, at one point we asked a question about whether or not people thought that Donald Trump was mentally stable, and it was split, with Democrats overwhelmingly saying that he was unstable and Republicans saying that they thought he was stable, but it was like 44% to 43% stable over unstable, and that was about his mental health. And he, you know, keeps on running the risk with his ignoring wearing masks, and that is why a lot of Republicans refuse to wear masks. Look at the legislature in Michigan here. They are meeting, and you can tell the Republicans from the Democrats because just about every Democrat, I think, has a mask on, and very few Republicans, if any, have a mask. And so the Republicans are without masks, and the Democrats wear them. And so
it's become a political symbol instead of a health symbol, whether you should do it or not. It's whether you're with Trump or against Trump, which is really not the way to really approach this at this point.
What if maybe if they started making MAGA face masks, they'd wear them.
Yeah, now there's an idea.
Copyrighted.
Yeah, I'm not sure that he would actually have any success. Of course, he markets everything else, so that's with it. I'll tell you what, one of the things that really does frighten me, that what I've heard about, is that he switched the convention to Jacksonville. And when he did that, he wanted it specifically that nobody had to wear a mask, and you know, they'd be jamming 15,000 people into that arena for his acceptance speech and things like that. That, to me, is going to be something that he might come to rue that day, because if there's a dramatic spike, especially in Florida, if people go and they go to other places in Florida and it dramatically goes up, he's created an issue in a state that he desperately needs to win. At this point. And I thought it was just an enormous gamble that he's not going to have anybody wear masks. Everybody might just be exposed to what's going on. And if that spike happens, he's going to have a real problem in that state, especially with the senior population that's in there.
Well, and I wonder if he's going to have the same kind of thing that, yeah, everybody come in, y'all come in and don't wear masks. But, oh, by the way, just like he did in this gathering he's having soon, you need to agree that you're not going to sue us or raise any issue if you get sick.
Yeah. But to me, it was just silly doing it in Florida. From a politically strategic standpoint, I know he needs Florida and he wants to campaign there. But if that spike happens, then he's dramatic. He's going to definitely be blamed for it.
Oh, no question about it. And
go ahead, Bunny.
I just wanted to note that there's such a dramatic difference in terms of the support he got in 2016 from seniors And now Biden is leading among seniors, and here in Michigan, he's leading by several points over Trump. So he is completely lost the senior vote, and that will have or could have a dramatic impact in Florida. And what's happening in Florida is also happening in a number of other states where the Republican governor has basically opened everything up. And whether it's the beaches or going to restaurants, and a lot of these states that opened up early are now seeing spikes in terms of the coronavirus and deaths.
Well, any other questions you had on there that were related to perhaps our budget or anything like that in the, here in the state of Michigan?
We did a question on vote by mail, because that is a very important issue. And we asked, Michigan approved voting reforms last year that included no reason mail in absentee voting for those who request it. Due to the coronavirus pandemic, elected officials are looking for ways to expand the use of vote by mail, which the following statements comes closer to your view. And 63% said voting by mail has been successfully used in Michigan and many other states, ensures the health and safety of all voters and election workers, and we should work to make sure Michigan voters have the opportunity to cast their ballot this way. 63% agreed with that. Only 33% agreed with voting by mail is not secure, and we should not encourage more use of it because it opens the door to widespread voter fraud. Now, among Republicans, only 66% agreed with the voter fraud statement, and almost 3 in 10, 27%, said that they agreed with the first statement. And overwhelmingly, like almost unanimous, 98% of Democrats and 69% of independents agreed with the first statement. So that is an issue that potentially could be used in campaigns if Republican legislators vote to restrict mail-in voting in any way, shape, or form. They have the potential of losing up to a third of 30% of their base, and that would probably not be a bright move.
Bernie, what I'm puzzled about, at least traditionally, it seems like that Republicans would vote by mail no matter what. I don't know. I think that it would be to their advantage to push for voting by mail. But I guess I'm puzzled by that, because the Republican Party in Trump have taken a strong stand against it.
Yeah, it's amazing to me because the last couple of times elections have been held, Republicans have won in vote-by-mail districts and states. And so it is puzzling to me that Trump is thinking that, everybody votes by mail, notwithstanding the fact that I think a majority of states have some level of vote-by-mail, and seven or eight are completely voting by mail. And so that seems odd. And don't forget, in the May election, you had 99%. Because of the fear of the coronavirus, voting by mail, voting by absentee ballot, and only 1% voting by showing up at the polls.
Okay. Well, I know we're going to take a break. We're going to have you for a few more minutes after the break, if that's all right. And then we're going to finish it up. So you're listening to 910 AM, the Superstation. Farrah, I believe we're supposed to take a break now, if I'm looking at the clock right. Yes, I hear the music. Okay. I appreciate it. You listen to 910 AM, the Superstation. I have Bernie Korn, also joined today by Chief Fisher, Willie Burton, and Tom Choske, and Scotty Boman. We'll be right back.
I made a decision, despite all the things that we go through. I'm going to take more time with you and be a friend to me.
Central Park Deli on Losser between 8 and 9 Mile Road is serving everything fresh and delicious. Open Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 9 p.m. and Saturdays from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. Central Park Deli will deliver to businesses from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. daily. At Central Park Deli, you will enjoy our hefty sandwiches, our delicious soups made fresh daily, our fresh made-to-order stir-fried dinners, and the best roll-up sandwiches in town, and a variety of meats such as club, buffalo chicken, Italian, Greek, hot corned beef, veggie roll-ups, and more. Central Park Deli offers a great dining experience, fast and efficient carryout, and fantastic tray catering for special events. Central Park Deli makes ordering your food in advance fast and easy with our new online platform and mobile app. Central Park Deli on Losser between 8 and 9 Mile Road is serving everything fresh and delicious.
Listen up, America. Are you or a loved one suffering with an addiction to alcohol, opiates, prescription painkillers, or other drugs? There is hope. Medication-assisted treatment is proven most effective for opiate addiction recovery. Utilizing medications such as methadone, Suboxone, and Subutex, combined with inpatient treatment, you can achieve lasting recovery. Most insurance is accepted, so call us now.
Please call 800-625-5860.
So, you've decided to go to college. That's cool. So, pop quiz. Which is a better way to earn your degree? Commute to college and fill your gas tank, get stuck in traffic, drive in bad weather, try to find a parking space, walk a half mile to class, or learn online at Independence University. You don't go to college. College goes to you. That's Independence. That's Independence University. And all your supplies, including a brand new laptop and tablet, are included with tuition. Independence U for an independent you.
Call 1-800-556-7791.
Good morning. You're listening to 910 AM Superstation. My name is Robert Ficano. We're going to spend until about 9:30 here with Bernie Korn. Bernie, any final thoughts on what your survey indicated, and or your polling, I should say, indicated? And do you see any impact on Gretchen Whitmer perhaps being for vice president? I mean, if he's winning by 12 points now in Michigan, I mean, some of the reason why they pick, you know, vice presidential candidates is try to swing a state that they may have a close race in. And it seems like he is such control that in, Vice President Biden is in Michigan that maybe he might go elsewhere for, you know, the vice presidential pick if he's really trying to balance it out in terms of what state he wants to win.
Well, the news just indicated, I think, a couple days ago that his choices are narrowing, and I think it was noted that Governor Whitmer is no longer on the list.
Yeah.
And and Susan Rice is now on the list. And I if I were a betting man, I would say that he is likely to go with a African American woman, either Kamala Harris or Stacey Abrams. Stacey Abrams, that would be a potential assistance in terms of picking up her state, and that would be, I think, a strong choice. Yeah, you go ahead.
No, yeah, I was going to say, Harris, I think, nationally would be a strong choice, but he's going to win California. I mean, if he doesn't win California, something's really wrong at this point. And so I don't hear about bad blood between them. I know with the confrontation that they had during the debate, during the second debate, I believe it was, that rubs some of Biden's people the wrong way. But I don't see that lingering right now in terms of her being picked for, as a vice presidential candidate. And she's come out pretty strong on all the social unrest that we've seen with the police and things like that, which I think has helped her credentials a little bit, even though she's a former attorney general.
Well, I have been very impressed with the many times that I've seen her recently speak on issues, and she's extremely articulate, and she's very strong in her in her presentation, and I would not be surprised, even though California, I think, is obviously an assumed victory for Biden. But, you know, this sleeper might be Susan Rice.
Yeah, that'd be interesting. She was a former... Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I was just going to say also, too, you can't write off Congresswoman Val Demings of Florida. She presents a great value to the campaign, being from Florida and helping to put that state in play, while she also has a bit more government experience than Stacey Abrams. So it's an opportunity for Joe Biden to still get some diversity on the ticket, bring a new perspective, but also really attack Trump hard in the South.
I was very impressed with her the couple of times that I've seen her, so I forgot to mention her. She would be, I think, a wonderful choice.
Wasn't she a former police chief? I can't remember. From Orlando? I can't remember.
Am I in the district around there? Yeah, I don't think it's the entirety of Orlando. I think Orlando might be split, but I could be wrong on that. But it is Central Florida.
In your polling, Bernie, do you see anything, people that are associated with either prosecutors or the police, dampening their chances at all, or were able to get in that depth?
I have not seen that, and I have not seen it in any of the national polling. I think that... the police that I have seen, like the sheriff of Genesee County, joining in on the march, I thought that was a class act, and there was no problem with the protest or anything else. And a lot of police are, I think, engaging in a way that that helps in terms of their image. However, there are still a few that. Are going overboard. That obviously they need to be dealt with, and if they are not dealt with, this movement is going to continue to widen. And it is just amazing when you consider the number of white folks that are involved in this whole whole issue, and that shows the strength of it, I think, and the likelihood that it's not going to go away anytime soon. By the way, there is one race that we did not cover, the U.S. Senate.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead. Peters and...
Peters and John James. Peters' favorability is 45-20 favorable. However, 22% still do not recognize Peters. And 13% recognize him, but are undecided. And James is at 23% non-recognized. However, he has 32% unfavorable, 31% favorable. And in the matchup, Peters has a 15.51-36% lead, with Peters getting 88% of Democrats and James getting 80% of Republicans, and Peters winning solidly among independent voters.
Yeah, it seems like if Biden holds with this 12-point lead, it seemed like that would really be a spike in the heart of John James trying to unseat an incumbent senator. It just that's a large number to overcome with the top of the ticket, it seems like, at this point.
And the other thing that you should not forget is that as you near the election, with the money that Mitch McConnell has in his various PACs and the decisions that have to be made by the Republican National Committee, when it comes right down to it, do you think that they're going to invest in James or trying to protect their majority by putting money into Lindsey Graham and all the folks that seem to be in trouble right now, with Democrats not only leading in terms of fundraising over the Republican incumbents, but also either even up or leading in the polls?
Okay. Interesting. Well, Bernie, I appreciate it. Thanks for taking the time on your Sunday to do this. Your polls are always fascinating, and I have to say they're always very, very accurate in terms of, you know, what they take a snapshot, and I realize polling is just a snapshot at that moment with it, but it also...
Things can change.
Yeah, and things can change at this point, but... I would say, I agree with you, I don't think Trump would pull out of the state of Michigan, but I don't think he'll see the same number of visits and resources if it stays this way. They're going to pick whatever narrow path he thinks he has to get the Electoral College. I already think he concedes he can't win the popular vote. So now what he's got to win is actually the Electoral College like he did last time. He'll try to sustain himself. So thank you very much. We appreciate it. And... we'll be having you back on. Thanks for coming back to 9:10 a.m. Appreciate it, Bernie.
Any time. Nice to be with you, Robert. Take care.
Thank you. Take care. Okay. To the rest of the panel, I know we had a little bit of a political discussion there. Just swinging it back on the last half hour as best we can. Some of the issues that have come up with some of the protesters now, between Scotty and Tom and Willie, do you see the movement as united as you think it should be at this point, or is it starting to splinter? Because we're starting to see, like, the one group was saying they want to have the public tribunal, I guess, in a park or someplace, where they want the mayor and the police chief to come in. And I'm not quite sure how that would work in terms of... what they set up and what they're trying to do at this point. Go ahead, somebody, Willie, was it? Or who's trying to say something?
Well, you know, there's some division that I've noticed, and one is that we have really the groups that are trying to work peacefully and negotiate policy, and then we have these agitators who are popping in there and trying to create physical conflict. I think either that's a big distinction to be made, because one really hurts the other in the sense that if people are willing to work toward a solution to the problems, then there isn't the need for escalating things to a different level. On the other hand, if you got people constant making it into a battle, basically, then there's not going to be any dialogue going on. And so I think that's something I've noticed, just kind of looking at things from the outside.
Well, it seems like if you have mechanisms to try to help, meaning policy-wise, like you have the Detroit Police Commission, you have the Detroit City Council, you have pressure points that can make a difference in policy. And I think some of it, like if when you completely, say, fund the whole police department, I think, you know, you're automatically drawing lines instead of trying to actually work out some type of policy to make it, better and more accountable at this point. And the transparency is really in the process and what decisions are made. And I think sometimes, like Willie said, like Police Commissioner Burton said, if Detroit was doing facial recognition because of PD for 2 years and nobody knew about it, that is scary in terms of, you know, accountability and letting people know what's going on within their own at this point.
You know, another thing too to bring up, building on that point, is so Bob, you asked if the movement's getting fragmented and some of the message and momentum's lost. You know, a lot of what Commissioner Burton has been fighting for on the police commission are the things that people have been out in the street protesting on. So the change that people are fighting for in the streets, Commissioner Burton is doing that in the boardroom, and that is helping to inspire the people out in the streets to continue the fight and to narrow the focus down to where, like Bob, like you said, and Scotty, we can make those changes. We also see that lack of transparency when asked about how much equipment Detroit Police has received through the Department of Defense's 1033 program. for those of you who don't know.
For the listeners who don't know what that is, that's the military equipment that is sent to the police department.
Exactly. Yeah, they said that. They said it's none, and that's absolutely ridiculous. I guarantee you that the department will revise that statement in the future in the next couple of weeks because they have military technology. They've gotten the Stinger system, for example, through that. I'm sure that there are certain firearms, some of the MRAP armored vehicles that they use. So very sure that statement will be revised. But that's the lack of transparency that we're dealing with. And, you know, Commissioner Burton's the only one out there fighting for the people to make sure that DTD is banned from participating in this program.
Well, one of the things, thank you so much, Mr. Tom Choske and Bob Ficano, Scotty Boman. One of the things I urge my colleagues is to listen to the voices of the people. You know, I'm calling on my colleagues to do the right thing, to be on the right side of history for a change. You know, citizens are saying, we want to end police access to military surplus equipment. And this is what the citizens of Detroit are saying. And so when we put a motion on the table and my colleagues, you know, don't want to allow the motion to go forward or whatever, or commissioners at the table saying, what is it? We have an attorney that represents our office, and for him to be silent and for other commissioners to say, well, I don't know what it is, I'm going to vote it down, it just let us know that when we should be moving forward, the oversight in Detroit is actually moving backwards. So I urge...
The commissioners didn't know what the military program was, my understanding anyway. A couple of them didn't understand what it was, actually, that the military was giving. Well, I guess you can get it very cheaply if you're Detroit PD. There's a program with the excess military to be giving them out the equipment.
Well, you know, Bob, you have two former police officers that were lieutenant for the Detroit Board of Police Commissioners. You've got Lisa Carter, former lieutenant for the Wayne County Sheriffs. You have Willie Bell, 30-some year veteran with the Detroit Police Department as a lieutenant. I assure you, they know what the 1033 program is, and they know about, you know, we talk about two individuals right here has a long extensive background in law enforcement, but not only that, it's all been in the media. It's all been in the papers. These are sitting commissioners. I mean, for those commissioners that are following their training or, you know, go to these training sessions each year for oversight, they should know what the 1033 program is. But more importantly, if blankly they didn't know, you have an attorney that represents our office. And if for him not to weigh in on it, shame on, shame on our office. Shame on the lack of communication. Shame on the lack of transparency. You know, for those commissioners don't want to know what's in the police department's inventory as far as military-grade equipment, I put a motion out there a week ago as well as this past week. I want them to respond back in writing about how much equipment they receive over the years, but also what is in the inventory and when was it ever used as far as deployment. And I'm still waiting. We're talking about the lack of transparency. Detroit ranks dead last when it comes to transparency.
Okay. And we have a caller on the text line. George, you're on. George? Okay. Well, we keep missing them today, Farrah, I guess. With it. You anticipate that anybody on the panel here, you anticipate that the contract for the facial recognition is going to be passed by the city council this Tuesday?
Yeah, we were told that something was on the table pertaining to facial recognition where they're going to be weighing in on. But, you know, once again, it's the same trade City Council that approved the $1 million grant that the Detroit Police Department is using right now for facial recognition. So I urge the Detroit City Council to do the right thing as well. Listen to your constituents. Listen to the voices of the people when they say, shut it down. We don't want it. We as America's poorest blackest city cannot afford to misidentify a single person of color that doesn't have the resources for a good legal defense. Bob, Tom, and Scotty, we all have said many times on this show that, you know, we cannot afford to misidentify one person, not a single person. And right now, everybody with a baseball cap, surgical mask, look-alike, or on camera. And I think, Bob, you raised that good point earlier today on the show.
One of the things, do you think it harms the credibility of some of the protesters saying that they want the public tribunal? I mean, nobody seems to know what the rules would be. They want, it seems like they just want to set up like what you saw in Minnesota where the Mayor Fry of Minneapolis did the walk of shame that, you know, going through. And I think our Mayor Duggan and Police Chief Craig aren't going to subject themselves to something like that going through it. And nobody knows, when you say a public tribunal, I'm not sure what that's supposed to, it's like they're on trial or something. And if you're on trial, there's rules of evidence and everything else. So I'm not sure if that doesn't hurt the credibility of what they're trying to do. Instead of go and meet with them, I know there was a meeting this week, and say, okay, here's some of the policy areas that we want to change with Detroit PD. And I don't know, do you think it's harming the credibility of the protesters asking for this tribunal?
You know, Bob, sometimes people talk about tribunals, but sometimes you also hear some of the protesters use the word commission, right? Like, they talk about the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. So for those of you who may not remember, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission was something in South Africa that they set up after Mandela came to power, the ANC came to power, to look back at apartheid and the damage that was done from apartheid and start to try to heal the nation from that. And a lot of the people are talking about having a similar Truth and Reconciliation Commission here because of all the damage that racism has wrought upon our community. And having it be more than just simply looking at the Detroit Police Department, it's looking at the entirety of our city, the entirety of our history, and how people have been marginalized throughout it in order to understand how we come out of it better, how we come out of it stronger. So I think that's an area where people gain a lot of credibility when they talk about those reconciliation commissions. Maybe not a tribunal, but definitely those commissions.
Yeah, the commissions are different. Commissions actually go back and say, okay, here's what was done, and here's what we think are some of the mistakes that might have been done, and here's how you correct it for the future. You see, there's famous commissions you've seen in history. The one that Tom just mentioned, South Africa, also we've had them in the United States. They called it the Warren Commission that was looking at the death of President Kennedy, where they tried to look back and see if they could figure out actually how that, you know, what events unfolded for that to happen in things such as that. And commissions are different. You're absolutely right. In the tribunal, is like you're on trial for what you did. It's almost like they try to do sometimes with the United Nations with war crimes and things like that. But I think this would set the wrong tone at this point. People would be very concerned about that. Go ahead.
Yeah, I wanted to comment on the city council vote. One thing I really like about those city council meetings is they have the citizen comments at the beginning instead of the end. And so it's at 10 a.m. on Tuesday, so I would urge anybody who has feelings on this issue to visit DetroitMI.gov, search for city council, look where they got the meeting posted, zoom into it a little ahead to deal with technical problems, and be ready to comment right at the stroke of 10, because it doesn't take long for them to get to them. And if enough people make their voice heard, they're going to have egg on their face if they pass that thing.
Well, Scotty, just a technical question. I think they can do it by phone, too, can't they? Or you got to do it by Zoom.
If you find that the link on the announcement on the Detroit City website, there is also code for where you dial a phone number, and then you put in, like, a meeting code, and then you could do it that way. And one thing you need to know, though, and they may not tell you, you got to push *9 if you want to raise your hand to be recognized. There's also a comment form you can fill out there. If, for instance, you want to email them a message, but you can't get on the Zoom.
Okay. The police commission, do they have their public comment at the end of the meetings, Willie?
Say that again, please.
Does the police commission have their comments at the end of the meeting?
No. Only for the public, but, you imagine that we will be able to say a few words after public comments to address the concern. But, the biggest thing here is that this board, the Detroit Board of Police Commission, is just not functioning the way it ought to function for the citizens of Detroit. I'm outraged with the failing leadership on this board with past chair Lisa Carter and also the new current sworn in chair, Willie Bell, out of District 4. These two individuals are not listening to the citizens of Detroit, and they were elected, 1 in 4, 1 in 6. So when citizens come out, and speak during public comments, and they raise their voices loud and clear, like shut down facial recognition or to demilitarize the police. And we want transparency. Well, we have not seen that with the leadership of these two individuals, Lisa Carter, Willie Bell, District 4. Yes, we calling you out. We the people are calling you out because you are a disservice to our community. You are a disservice to be a commissioner. And once again, next year, for those citizens that are listening to the voters, you can always vote out this rubber stamp leadership.
One of the issues that I know comes up about really the length of investigations, if a police officer is accused of some type of excessive use of force or abuse of some kind, the investigation seems to go on forever. And some of it is because of the collective bargaining agreement. And it might be, when we talk about some of the reforms, one of the reforms might be having strict guidelines or deadlines of when investigations are started, how long they should take, and then, how long to make a determination of what you're supposed to do. And some of these you've seen have gone on for a really long time. It's in a little bit in a different arena, but it's the same thing like you're seeing with the narcotics. I think it's twice now that the complete narcotics squad in Detroit PD has been wiped out by the chief. And the second time is, again, an investigation that's going on, but it's been going on a really long time. I want to say months. And it's being done internally by Detroit PD. And if there is such a culture, as the chief has said, that there's a culture of, impropriety within the narcotics unit, probably an outside agency is one that could better feather that out instead of having, in essence, Detroit PD investigating itself at this point.
I agree 100% with you, Bob. I have never seen a police department police themselves or investigate themselves, without going to the outside entity, like MSP, or as an example. Yes, the narcotics unit was raided twice. It was renamed. The division was renamed, and then it was also restaffed twice, and you still have abuse within the division or that unit. But another thing is, whatever happened to
the officer was supposedly alleged of forging the chief's signature. We never heard any feedback about that. It's like we haven't got any updates about what's going on with the narcotics unit, which is now major violator. They call it the major violators unit now. But still, there is no update. We don't know who was disciplined.
Has it ever been determined who forged the chief's signature on implement for a discipline agreement on the situation of the DMC? I can't remember what it was for particularly, but I remember that was actually the chief said his signature was forged, yet we never heard who actually did it, did we?
Well, you know, once again, I mean, we haven't heard anything else about it. I mean, you can get to the bottom of it. Are they signing off with military grade equipment?
Okay. All right. Well, I want to thank everybody for not only calling in, but our guests today that appeared on our program. You're listening to 910 AM, the Superstation. I want to thank Farrah for helping run the board and everything that she does. And I want to thank, obviously, Police Commissioner Willie Burton, Tom Choske, and Scotty Boman. And as we said, our special guest that we had on as well. You're listening to 910 AM, Superstation. We're going to be back with you again next week from 8 to 10. My name is Robert Ficano.
Thank you, Robert.
It's like the devil's trying to work to give an idol up. And though I'm blessed, I still got to handle the things I go through. It's good to have.